Ah, well, I'll start recording here. Okay. So this theorem saying convergent sequences are Cauchy. And I'll tell you, I'll post a link to these notes that I've got in Canvas. Okay. So here's another property of Cauchy sequences that we are going to need here. So here's our theorem. Okay, Cauchy sequences are bounded. Okay, now remember, if we're trying to prove something is bounded, we need to have the precise definition of what it means for a sequence to be bounded in our working memory here. So a sequence is bounded if there exists big M greater than or equal to zero, so that absolute value of A sub n is less than or equal to big M for all natural numbers little n. Okay, so if we are to show that a sequence is bounded, we have to produce the capital M that exceeds every term in the sequence. Okay, so if you're telling me a sequence is bounded, you've got to show me the bound. All right, now we know the sequence is Cauchy. So we know given epsilon greater than zero, there exists big N such that for N and M greater than big N, these guys are within epsilon of each other. Couple of things to also note. This inequality right here holds okay. So whenever I have a real number, I know my sequence is Cauchy. So whenever I'm given a real number epsilon, I can produce a big N such that this is true. Okay. So here's what we're going to do to show our sequence is bounded. So since we know I can produce that big N for any epsilon, I can produce it for epsilon equals one. So there exists an N in the natural numbers such that for M and N greater than capital N, the difference between any two terms in the tail of the sequence is less than one, as long as these subscripts exceed this capital N. Okay, also note this. Note that M and N don't necessarily need to be consecutive terms in the sequence, right? Let's say capital N is 100, for example. Okay, after term number 100, the terms in the sequence are within one of each other. This could be like term 500, and this could be term 6 million. Okay, it's still got a hold whenever the subscripts are bigger than this cap. Okay, so in particular, it's got a hold for like this. Okay, what did I do there? It was a tiny little change, but it's important.
You made the M a big N?
Right, I made the M a big N. So notice here, whenever the subscripts are at least as big as this N, this inequality holds. In particular, if one of the subscripts is equal to that big N and the other one exceeds it, then the inequality holds. So, over here I need to go back and change a little thing right here. I'm going to do a little bit of finagling on that. I want the inequality going that way, and I want that to be a minus. I could make it happen by doing an add and subtract the same thing and applying the triangle inequality. Okay, so go back in your notes and make that alteration there. Okay. So I've got this here. Now, of course, that's equal to this. Which is, actually, no, I think I want them. I want the cap to be on A sub N. So this is at least as big as okay. So I want to be able to say this. This is my goal. Okay, so I want to kind of add that over. So I've got one. One will be a cap on this. Which is a cap. Yeah, okay. I think I need it this way. Now if I add the A sub N, the A sub big N to both sides, now I get this. Okay. I just had to make sure I had everything in the right order. So I was looking at the conclusion I wanted to get and then trying to fill in the steps in the middle. Okay. So once I hit this capital N, the terms are bounded by this number right here, a sub big N plus 1. And what we're going to do is we're going to take capital M to be equal to the max of a 1, a 2, dot, 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 a n minus 1, a sub cap n, and then a plus 1 over here. Okay, these terms might actually be bigger, so that's why we're kind of hedging our bet there. We only know this inequality holds once we reach capital N. Now, of course, capital N is a finite number. So this is a finite set, so it has a max. Okay, so we actually did something like this a little while ago when we were proving convergent sequences were bounded. Okay, it was a similar idea. We looked at a max of a collection of terms in the sequence. All right. So here's the kind of the key result for this section, the Cauchy criteria. A sequence converges if and only if it is Cauchy. All right, now, you've all taken foundations, right? The ones in this Zoom meeting right now, anyway, right?
Yeah.
Okay, right. So we've got an if and only if proof. So what does that mean?
You did prove it
both. Right. So an if and only if proof, you really need to do two proofs. Okay, so one of the proofs we'll have to do is if a sequence converges, then it's Cauchy. Okay, so why is that the easy way? Look back in your notes.
Could we use, like, just like state another theorem that's been proven?
Right, right. In fact, we outlined the steps for that already. One of our first result, in fact, about Cauchy sequences was if a sequence is convergent, then it's Cauchy. And we got the key steps for that. We didn't actually do the formal write up. I put that into your homework, but we got the idea there. Okay, so that's actually done already. That's why it's easy. It's easy because it's already done. formal write-up is exercise 2.6.1. So that's number one. Oops, nope. The second part of the proof is to go the other way. We have to take a sequence that is Cauchy and show that it is convergent. Now, the critical idea here is we need a value for the limit A. We need to be able to say what it converges to, and then we can prove it's convergent, right? Because we have to use the definition of a convergent sequence. So we have to take a Cauchy sequence, which doesn't involve that value A, and establish that value A actually exists. All right. So we're going to use the theorem that we just proved. So what was that again? The theorem that we talked about right before this, when it said Cauchy sequences were
bounded
sequences. Now, last class, we had a result about bounded sequences. What was it?
Every bounded sequence has a convergent subsequence.
Okay, right. So we know Cauchy sequences are bounded sequences. The Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem tells us that if you got a bounded sequence, it has a convergent subsequence. Okay. So that's going to be the critical idea here. So Cauchy implies bounded. So A sub n is a Cauchy sequence, implies A sub n is a bounded sequence. Okay, A sub n sub k. All right. So the Bolzano-Weierstrass theorem guarantees that we have this convergent subsequence. Now, this is more of an outline than my formal write-up right here. So this will be scratch work. Okay, so suppose that the limit as k goes to infinity of a sub n sub k equals a. Okay, this converges. So let me call this thing a. What we'll need to do is establish that a sub n also converges to A. Okay, so there's a slight little wrinkle here, but we're going to get to use the fact that this thing is Cauchy to establish that if the subsequence terms go to A. So the idea here is that we've got this subsequence. Maybe not every single term. Maybe it's like every other one, let's just say, for an example. So we have a sequence where we're taking every other term. We know those get close to this limit A, all right? But we also know that because the sequence is Cauchy, if you get out to the tail, the terms get close together, all right? So the subsequence can be made arbitrarily close to A, but the terms in the actual sequence can be made arbitrarily close to each other. So that's going to be the key step. So I eventually want to say something about this. I eventually want to say that A sub n minus A less than epsilon. So this is my goal. Now, what I can say is A sub n sub k minus A, I can make that arbitrarily small. Okay, but I've got to work in some A sub m's. And this is going to hold for n sub k greater than or equal to some big k in n. Okay, the reason I'm using big k is because the subsequence is indexed by k. All right. Now, the fact that these things are Cauchy implies.
Okay, Mac.
Yeah, go ahead.
Can you go back to the page before?
All right. Yeah.
All right, yeah, got it.
Okay. So the fact that these things, the sequence is Cauchy, implies that there exists a capital N in the natural numbers, such that for M and N exceeding that cap, the terms in the sequence can be made arbitrarily close together. In particular, this would hold as long as n sub k also exceeds my cap. Right now, here's what we're going to do. My key inequality. I need to make this thing small, okay? Well, this is equal to A sub n minus A sub nk plus A sub nk minus A. Okay, that's less than or equal to A sub n minus A sub nk plus A sub nk minus A. Now, I can make this quantity small because it's Cauchy. In particular, I could make it less than epsilon over 2. And I can make this quantity small because A sub nk converges to A. And of course, the whole point of the epsilon over 2s is since I've got these two quantities, combine them, you get epsilon. So this quantity can be made less than epsilon. Okay. So I want you to read section 2.6 for your homework assignment. I gave you a couple of problems from section 2.5, I believe. 2.51 and 2.52. And I want you to try 2.63 as well. So see if you can get those done by Friday, along with the ones from 2.5. Okay. I'll put the assignment up on Canvas. Okay, you've got my link to afternoon office hours. I don't know if school's going to be open tomorrow. Who knows? If school is closed, then I'll just keep that link for tomorrow's office hours as well, and I'll send you something for the morning, too. Okay, so any other things before we wrap up? Okay, so I'm going to need to close this meeting and head to my 11 o'clock class.